good news, if Mueller tries to subpoena us, we're going to court. Joining us now from Manchester, New Hampshire, President Trump's first campaign manager and court advisor, Corey Lewandowski. Corey, is that the president's view, that he cannot be compelled to testify and that he cannot, as the president, obstruct justice?
Well, Chris, I think, look, I'm not an attorney, so I'm being very clear about this, but what this Mueller outlines and what their team has said was, if the Mueller team is going to potentially subpoena the president, that is something that they believe is not authorized because of his position. Now, what they're trying to do, Chris, is they're trying to sit down and figure out if the president is going to sit down for an interview, and that interview is really based on a narrow scope of questions that the team is trying to negotiate right now. But what Rudy Giuliani has said, as the president's attorney, is if the Mueller investigators decide to subpoena this president, they will take it to court, and I believe the court is going to be on the president's side on this.
But, and this specific issue has never been adjudicated, but there is a long history of the courts ordering presidents to do something, and presidents agreeing to do it. A subpoena is a court order. Thomas Jefferson had to bow to a court order. Richard Nixon had to bow to the Supreme Court in releasing the Watergate tapes.
And his team are saying is, you don't need to go to the subpoena route, but if you do, we will fight it in court. The president's been very clear. He's offered to sit down with the Mueller investigators, but he has said, and the Giuliani team has said this, they want to understand what the scope of the questions are going to be before they sit down and do that.
I want to just try to narrow this down a little bit. Giuliani says if Mueller gets a subpoena, which is a court order, Giuliani and the president's legal team are going to go to court. What if the court says no, Mr. President, you're wrong? Is the president prepared under his understanding of his powers in the executive branch? Is he prepared to defy a court order?
I don't think so. I respect the president, but that's a question for the legal team. If they can come up to a resolution which is going to ask the president to sit down and have a conversation which is limited in scope, present the interrogatories, then the team will decide if the president's willing to do this. Because at the end of the day, what the Mueller investigators can do is they can write a report to Congress and to the Justice Department and show that there was no collusion between the president and the Russians, and that's where we are. So if the president is asked to sit down and discuss this, he's going to say exactly that, because I know it to be true. You know it to be true. You know that there's no collusion between the Ukraine and the Russians.
I want to talk about another part of the memo. We again should point out this was a memo that was written by the president's former legal team in January, including John Dowd. This week, he pardoned Dinesh D'Souza, a conservative author, this week, going around the normal process, according to the Justice Department, the office of pardon attorney. He did it unilaterally. He says he may pardon Martha Stewart. He may pardon former Illinois Governor Rod Blagojevich. The top Democrat on the House Intelligence Committee said even before his latest round of pardons that he saw a path of hearing.
To send a message, basically, I will use the pardon power to pardon people even if they're convicted of leaking and obstructing justice. If you are with me, I am.
And longtime Trump advisor Roger Stone said this: it has to be essential to Mike Flynn and Paul Manafort and even Robert Mueller. Indict people for crimes that don't pertain to Russian collusion, and that is why. special counsel's investigation.
Well, Chris, the Constitution is very clear, and the power of the president, as defined by the Constitution, allows him to pardon anybody he wants for federal crimes. And no one is talking about the pardon of the heavyweight boxing champion, Jack Johnson, that he pardoned, something that the Obama administration had the opportunity to do, and others chose not to. And so people want to make this a political issue. The pardoning of Dinesh D'Souza was a one-off, but this president has pardoned, I think, 0.7% of the applicants for president, which is a far more number than any previous president at this point. And so look, is he going to pardon one or two people? Like, it was not, right? Those are personal friends of the president back then who had crimes committed against him. Chris, there's absolutely no evidence whatsoever that the president has ever discussed having a pardon for Mike Flynn or Paul Manafort or anybody else for that matter. With all due respect to Roger Stone, I don't think he has any idea what he's talking about. This is not a sign. I don't know the president's relationship with Dinesh D'Souza. I don't know. I had never met Dinesh D'Souza, so I don't think there's a strong relationship between the president and him. But he looked at that particular case, saw an injustice that was done, which, by the way, there's a selective enforcement by the previous administration for a campaign finance violation, the same exact finance violation I think Roseanne Barr has admitted to, giving too much money to candidates and willing to prosecute her for that. And so the president pardoned Dinesh D'Souza on a one-off opportunity. But never, ever, ever did this president say, to the best of my knowledge, he's even bitten by a lawyer like Mike Flynn. States, no question.
All right, I want to go to a couple of other subjects. Let's turn to Spygate, the allegation by you and others, and of course by President Trump, that the FBI inserted a spy into the campaign. Here's what President Trump said, and also what Republican Congressman Trey Gowdy said after he got a classified briefing from the Justice Department and the FBI.
From the FBI as the campaign manager for 18 months of that campaign. Never did they notify me of their concerns about potential Russian meddling. Never did they notify me or anybody else while I was there of a potential spy entering the campaign. Never did they notify anybody that I'm aware of that they had those concerns. And what is more disturbing to me is there was only one campaign that was involved in the general election that took $5 million, went out and hired a former spy to go create a false dossier to spy on American citizens. And that was the Clinton campaign. And it doesn't sound like they were so concerned that they could spy into that campaign. Well, this looks like potentially selective enforcement of this took place. And if it did take place, Chris, there had better be accountability for sending a spy. Now, Flapper says that's not the term we're using in the United States. We're going to use the term spy. You call that too much.
Committee involved in raising money and supporting Republican candidates in the midterms. Here's some of what President Trump has been saying about Democrats on the campaign trail.
Remember the term chicken ass. They don't want the wall. They want open borders. They're more interested in taking care of criminals than they are in taking care of you. We are going to protect your Second Amendment. You won't have a Second Amendment if the Democrats take over.
And the president, Nancy Pelosi, will end this 13.
president tried to negotiate to get money for the wall and take care of the people that came to this country through no fault of their own, and the Democrats didn't want to do it because they want to politicize it. So this president has to remind the American people of what is at stake in the 2018 elections, and that is moving our country in the same direction, which is the lowest unemployment for African Americans and Hispanics ever recorded, and going back to the ways of more money in taxes and increasing their taxes under what would be Speaker Pelosi and to clear that economy. And I think the president's on the right track.
All right. Thank you. Thanks for joining us today. Always good to join you. Next, we'll bring in our Sunday panel to discuss what's going on in the national TV media and this sexual outrage. Later by TBS. Your thoughts about all of this?
You see, that's something that Roseanne Barr's comments. As you say, hateful. But if you're trying to think of something to say about a woman, it would be worse than what she said. I used to see, which is, I would say, secondhand, the end word, the ugliest word to her, particular parts. It could be anybody, but she said, the man is misogynistic and uses her body part.
Responsibility and freedoms different. Marie, how do you answer, Casey?
Well, private corporations can make decisions based on what they think is in their best business interest. And we've seen a couple of businesses boycott the Anthony show that may continue, it may not. So while both of these cases, Roseanne and Samantha Bee, they are able to say these things, they are also very much able to face consequences if they do so. And it would be interesting to see if ABC decide this is not in their corporate interest.
Regrettable in picking up on what Marie was
when
saying.
When you say you don't, you're saying you don't think there's a double standard?
No. I think that I agree with what Marie was saying in the sense that the culture is in this place where we use this kind of blank and vulgar language. But when you think about what Roseanne Barr had to say in terms of calling down a jack and ape, a black woman, this is something that's very deep and speaks to race in our culture, dehumanizing people. It speaks to oppression, slavery. I can go on. I think that calling two white women having an eye on immigration policies separating children from parents and women is, as I was going to say,
manner of horrible things about all manner of women. Yes, right.
But I'm telling
working
you,
in the Trump White
I'm
House.
Telling you, one of these items speaks to tearing at the social fabric in a way that can't be undone and puts us all in great danger. And then therefore, it's not about team sport in terms of, oh, I'm a Trump supporter, and I will therefore support Jose Marte. I'm an Obama supporter, and I do support Samantha Bee. That's really juvenile compared to the seriousness of what's taking place. You think about the NFL players. You think about Charlotte Smith. I can go on. And you understand that they're playing here to set somebody else in society.
Said, and while Roseanne Barr, her tweet was totally unacceptable and racist, it was a tweet in the middle of the night. That is a different context than Samantha Bee's rant, which was scripted, it was in a teleprompter, it was a comment that was clearly premeditated and made it through multiple layers.
Okay, that must take hours later. I want to move to another subject here, and that is the Russian investigation, because we do have this news of the president's legal team back in January sending this memo. Rick, you and I have come to a lot of scandals on that, and they're taking a very forward-leaning position on the presidential powers when it comes to obstruction of justice, when it comes to how to sit down and ask for a subpoena, when it comes to pardon. The question whether he would have to answer process, that is to say, respond to a subpoena, I think is another. We do know that the Supreme Court has ruled that Richard Nixon had to produce material evidence, which he did. Whether that would extend to sitting for an interview or being called before a grand jury has never been fully adjudicated, but I think the proof may be on not a strong ground there.
Okay, we'll see.